Frenchie's Art Gallery, located on historic Oak Street beside the Maple Leaf Bar. With over 3,000 square feet of space, it features a large gallery front room and Frenchie's personal art studio. Frenchie's Art Gallery is also connected to the Maple Leaf Courtyard, which is ideal for the New Orleans night scene. Frenchie's Art Gallery, 8314 Oak Street. Yeah, you're right.
Located at 109 Wall Boulevard in Gretna, Uniforms by Logo Express provides school uniforms, medical wear, hospitality wear, safety and industrial wear, and so much more. We offer a number of locations on both sides of the river, two in Chantilly, one in Woodmere, and our main store located in Gretna. Uniforms by Logo Express. Your brand starts here.
But here's the bottom line. Well, it's funny that you say that. Let me tell you. Good evening, New Orleans, and welcome to the seventh edition of Primetime Sports with Scott Alexander. Hey, it started at 68, and now it's down to 4. We'll get into that in a little bit, but first, I got to say hello to my band, Derek Freeman and the MFG. Of course, that's Derek on drums. My man, Devin Taylor over there on the tuba, and big game, James Martin over there on the saxophone. Guys, what's up? How you doing, my friends?
What's up, Scott? How you doing?
Hey, Derek, we're going to get in some tournament talk. We all got a little pool going. Yeah. And little did we know that big game James was going to start the back, and now he's in the front. We'll have some fun with that because we have a special guest also, Aaron Wilkinson from the Honey Island Swamp Band, who's in on it with us. We'll get into that. But as far as the band goes, festival season coming up, what do you guys have on tap coming up for us to watch?
Well, actually, we got a bunch of things happening. But just a week ago, Fife Dog from the legendary Tribe Called Quest died. And James and I happen to be in a Tribe Called Quest tribute band called the Low End Theory Players. So we're doing a tribute to Fife at the Joy Theater on April 8th,
right.
At the French Quarter Fest. The proceeds are to benefit the Musicians Clinic to raise awareness for diabetes and musicians living healthy.
Great stuff. Hey, by the way, I mean, Fife Dog, that was a tough couple weeks for an older guy like me. Fife Dog 45, but other guys, Joe Garagiola, who used to call all the games in the 70s for baseball. That was the only game of the week. He passed away. The White Shadow, Ken Howard, passed away, and you had a couple others. So it was a tough week, but we'll get more with the band. I'm very grateful and fortunate to have them each and every week, and I can't thank them enough, so I want to do it publicly as much as I can. Now we have to talk tournament. Hey, I've got John Brady, my final week of having him as the NCAA correspondent. Of course, he is the former LSU coach that took the Tigers to the Final Four back in 2006. He's been coaching Arkansas State for the last 8 years. And then we're also going to have Ed Conroy join us to talk about that as well. He is the former Tulane coach. But as far as the guys playing right now, well, it all starts with Buddy Hield. That was my team that I picked to win it all. They still have a long way to go. Hey, they've got 2/3 of it done. They've got 4 wins, but this guy has been killing it, averaging 30 points in the tournament. He was averaging 25 during the season. It's been amazing what he's done the whole way through. Hey, Villanova, Jay Wright, the head coach right there, this is going to be his second Final Four. Hey, they lost to Roy Williams, so if he gets to the final against North Carolina, he has his chance of redemption, and there's Roy Williams, but Jim Boeheim is the other guy. Boeheim has been unbelievable. That shocking win. I mean, I had Virginia in the final, so it hurt me, but I got to give it up because these coaches, they've been there before. We're going to get into that later, but as far as this goes, they have 17 Final Fours between them. Roy Williams, well, he's got 4 with Kansas. He didn't get it done. Remember the last year he coached at Kansas? They lost at the end, and then now it's 4 with Carolina. But as far as it goes, hey, don't forget, we also have Mike Dunleavy was not named head coach today, but he was introduced to the media as the new Tulane head coach, and we're going to talk a little bit about him with Ed Conroy. And also, don't forget, Saints free agency. Here's a graphic of the bonanza that's already happened. Mike Detillier is going to get into all these guys. They just signed Nick Fairley. We go into detail with Mike Detillier. It's going to be great. And don't forget the Louisiana Derby. I'd be remiss not to talk about the horses. Hey, Tom and Gail Benson, they're the big names because, hey, listen, Mo Tom and Tom's Ready have now qualified for the Kentucky Derby, Run for the Roses. We hear about them. They had the group. Sean Payton was there, just like the entire brass. You see the Derby hats behind. But also, I have to throw up, Gun Runner is also going, and he's the one that blew away the field, so it would be definitely wrong not to mention him. He also won the previous race over there at the fairgrounds. Hey, it's going to be a great show. You heard it. It's going to be Detillier. It's going to be John Brady. It's going to be my man Ed Conroy, and then Aaron Wilkinson from Honey Island Swamp Band. We'll be back right after this.
Watching WLAE, New Orleans Public Television. Find us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter.
Welcome back, Crescent City, and of course that is Derek Freeman in the MFG, and our special guest tonight, well, you're going to see him in a little bit, Aaron Wilkinson, who heads the Honey Island Swamp Band, and you know the guy hidden behind him, you can see the tuba, well that's Devin Taylor, of course Big Game James on the sax, and our leader of the band, well that of course is Derek Freeman, he's on the drum, so we'll get in a little bit, we had some fun with him talking about the NCAA tournament, and we're not done doing that, we're going to do that later in the show with John Brady and Ed Conroy, and believe it or not, well, Aaron Wilkinson was in our little pool, so we'll get in with that in the next segment. But I've been waiting for this segment since I started this show. This is our seventh show, and I said, you know what? I want to get Mike Detillier on, but I want to wait until it gets closer to the draft because this guy is the guru of New Orleans, Louisiana, and the South. Hey, let's call it the nation. The guy knows what he's talking about. Everybody subscribes to his book, magazine during draft time, and you will too. We'll tell you how to do that later, but it's called the M&D Draft Report. Of course, you also know him on WWL. He's with Bobby Hebert. He does that show. We know what it is. Second guest on Monday nights, but he's all over the place. Here he is, Mikey D.
How you doing, brother?
What's up, my
good
friend? How are you?
My pleasure. You got me on when I was broke down, you know.
You're broke down?
I'm broke down. Way, way too many long nights.
You have had a lot of long nights.
Goodness. And not out partying either. Actually working. So.
Making some money at least, hopefully.
Yeah. We almost finished up with the book.
Right.
I have one more day left to finish up and then have it out sometime next week.
Well, the draft obviously is like a month from now, literally just about. So kind of tell people, I want a little backstory. How'd you get started? It's called the M&D Draft Report. And if you haven't read one of these, you got to get it. I'm not trying to pimp it out. It is unbelievable. I've seen a lot of similar kind of books. The detail that goes into every player and the teams and the needs and all that is second to none. So give us kind of a background. How'd you get going on this?
Wow. My mom always tells a story. I could have done this when I was 12 or 13.
Right.
And she's probably right. I could have done something similar. So it's 30 years for me doing this. So it's been a long ride.
So you started when you were like, what, 7 years old?
Then? Yeah, right. I wish. But I started back mid-80s with it. And man, it's worked out great. Hit it right off the bat. I was fortunate in this business. The two guys that kind of started TV in New Orleans got slung to radio. So I worked, Hap Gaudy was the first guy to give me my shot. I had WWL at that time. Hap had went from
Legend.
TV to radio. And then after Hap passed away, I worked with Buddy DeLiberta all those years. And so that was a real trip. So now I've went from Hap to Buddy to Hebert. All in kind of three dominant.
Diction.
Oh my goodness! Yeah, right. Buddy.
And then of course Marble Mouth Buddy, who's a legend, of course. All three legends and yourself as well. Let's get into football though. I'm ready to get this. I know the Saints fans are. They've had, as we saw in the open, they did a free agent bonanza. You know, considering that they don't have a lot of money, it's one thing with the Giants going, you know, spending $107 million. It's another with teams that had the money. Jacksonville, among others, Oakland Raiders spent a lot, but. But as far as the Saints, we didn't think they had much money going in. It seems like every year Mickey Loomis pulls these magic tricks. And let's start at the beginning. The one they got yesterday, Nick Fairley. How'd they do it, and how's he going to fit in with this team?
Well, one of the guys that doesn't get a lot of credit for this is Kai Harley, who really is their salary cap expert. He's the guy behind the scenes that kind of filters this money out. And I don't mind them kind of knocking the ball around a little bit down the road. It's the dead money that's killed this team. And that's not what you're dealing with here. Listen, with Nick Fairley, what you get is a rent player. You get a guy that has been kind of cut loose by two teams.
Yep.
He's been a flash player. At times, he has looked like a guy we saw at Auburn. But most of the time, he's been a stock market player, up and down. Why do you think all of a sudden that's going to change? What you're going to get is, additionally, at this point, a guy up front that can give you some pass rush. Especially if you put him as a defensive end in a 3-4 alignment, that's where really he's been effective. But you're not getting a guy that's going to solve your problems along the defensive line.
Well, let's talk about what he did with the Lions, because I think this is what they're hoping for. It's not that long ago that he was drafted first-round pick. I mean, obviously he won the national title with Auburn. We'll get in that in a second. But the guy that played with Ndamukong Suh, and it helps to have a guy like that next
year. Yeah, well, I want to play next to Suh also.
But can he get some lightning in a bottle? This is going to be a one-year prove-it deal for about $3 million. Talk about what he did with the Lions, and is it possible?
Well, what I like what I saw with him with the Rams a year ago,
okay,
where he did give you that pass rush occasionally. But again, when you look at it, he had Aaron Donald on the side of him, another guy that's a big-time football player, and Robert Quinn played half the season on the edge. So basically, Scott, you got a rent player. You got a guy that might flash it, which you've never seen from Nick Fairley as a pro player, consistency. And I think that's where – you know, in this league, there are rent players and there are buy players. At this point, Fairley brings you to rent. 1 year, let's see what he can do. Hopefully, he can give you some push up the middle and maybe take the place of Kevin Williams, who last year I thought really played well. You talk, man, I'd love to have got the 23-year-old Kevin Williams.
Sure.
You got a guy in his 30s who I thought did some really solid work. That's what you hope you can get out of Fairley.
Last thing on Fairley, quickly. You get possibly the knucklehead Fairley. You think he's grown up. A lot of these arrests were in 2012. He still had some time. We see him in court. He's got that little look right here, is crossing his eyes. You see him with the mug shots. You know, he's got the serious mug shot. Then he has the one smiling. I think he decided he looks better with the smile. He does have a beautiful one. Any chance of this reoccurring? Because I know Sean Payton had put so much emphasis on cleaning up this locker room. What do you think? The young Fairley, or you think this guy's grown up a little bit?
Got to take a chance with a player.
Right.
If you're convinced he can help you, then you got to take a chance. And it's not costing you a tremendous amount of money. So that's when you can make that deal on a one-year shot here for Fairley. What happens in the future, who knows? But I know one thing. He's a talented guy.
Mm-hmm.
And that guy is going to get many more chances than the blue-collar guy. Like it or don't like it, nothing's fair in this world. He's going to get another shot here. What happens to him? All up to the guy in the mirror, up to himself, of what type of player he can be.
All right, the opposite kind of player, another guy they flirted with, another former Ram, well, that's James Laurinaitis, and he's the kind of guy you can rely on. He hasn't missed a single game in his entire career. He's a reliable guy, but a lot of eyebrows were raised, not mine, but a lot of other people. Like, we already have Stephon Anthony, but this is a quarterback, a leader. Tell us, well, James Laurinaitis, he's only been in the league 7 years, and some people say he's washed up, but does he have anything left in the tank, and what can he provide for this team?
Yeah, he's got plenty left in the tank, but what he brings to the table is he's your alpha dog. You know, and you need that on defense. I don't want to compare him to Jonathan Vilma, but in essence, that's something that this football team has not had post-Vilma. They have not had a leader, a guy to take charge, and mentally he knows what to do, but even better, he can tell you what needs to be done. How many times last year did we see this team over and over and over again? Mental mistakes, breakdowns on the field. You have to have a guy that can quarterback that defense, and that's what he can do for you. what a lot of people wrote about, well, he had difficulties getting off of blocks last year. Well, if I'm a coach and you've got a couple of them on deck, they won't tell you if a guy's injured. He had an injured elbow for the last half the season. So it's difficulty for him to get off that block nearly as quick as he used to, but he still had over 100 tackles. He never missed a game. Your leader, that's what you need on a very young defense that's going to get even younger.
He said he was shocked. I mean, he even said that the Rams had kind of talked to him about being their spokesman when they move out to L.A. So he said this came as a big shock to him.
And he must not have seen how much they're going to pay him. the bottom line comes down to dough.
When you have too much of a salary, it's either take a big pay cut or you're gone. And the Saints, we all know what that's happened a lot, most recently with Jyre Evans. Hey, as far as this defense goes, though, you know, the 4-3 defense, you know, we've seen this mostly. They usually play a 4-2-5. There's talk about how Willie Kakaha going, putting his hand back in the dirt where he was so successful at Washington.
Man, if he puts his hand in the dirt and I see him on first and second down, I'm running the ball right at him. A 245-pound guy with his hand in the dirt, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to slow down his pass rush by running right at him. But you got to play with the cards that are dealt to you. This draft is important. Because if you don't get your defense fixed and quick, what you're staring at in Carolina is a team that could be there for another 5, 6, 7 years intact.
Wow.
And you staring at a situation similar to in the 80s when Jim Moore was staring at with the 49ers, a team dominant. And when you look at that young talent they have, all I'm telling you, Scott, you better get it fixed and quick on defense.
Good point. So you're saying, hey, leave him at linebacker and let the chips fall where they
may? No, I think you're going to have to move him around a little bit. That's where he's most effective. But if you think you're going to play him as a down defensive lineman on first and second down, first time I see him out there, I'm running the football right at him.
But it's a catch-22 with him, isn't it? Because, I mean, this is a guy that obviously suffered in pass defense. He did get better as the season went along, but we saw those early preseason games. The quarterback's eyes lit up because he wasn't backpedaling. So where does this guy end up? I mean, you're saying you could put him down there. Is he too much of a tweener right now?
Yeah, he is a bit of a tweener player, right. And it's to find the right niche for him.
Okay.
As a pass rusher, that's where I want him on the field. Because he can get up the field and rush the quarterback. He's instinctive to do that. But he's much better, in my opinion, on that third down situation where you know where he's going to be.
Right.
But move him around a little bit, left and right. Try to get you an advantage on your part to use his pass rush skills the best you can. But, you know, he was a rookie. Stephon Anthony got beat in a coverage game, too. I mean, that's just part of the game. And in the NFL today, and I put a lot of emphasis on it when I look at linebackers today, can you cover? Because you know what? Then that makes you a down guy. You might play first down, maybe second. Sure. On third down, they've taken you out to put in a safety or another cornerback. That's what the NFL has gotten to. It's basically specialization.
We're with Mike Detillier, draft analyst, heck, football analyst. We're going to continue. We're going to get in the draft in a second, but I want to talk about a couple of the free agents. They went big. With Kobe Fleener, are they trying to get Jimmy Graham in a bottle again? You know, they got the guy with the 4.5 speed, 6'6", 250. He's got all the measurables, but can he be a Jimmy Graham for Drew Brees?
Well, this was the guy you could tell Sean Payton wanted from right after the season was over with. A big target guy, a positioning player, almost like a basketball player out on the football field, where you can use that 6'6" length. He's got a 79.5-inch arm span. Man, listen, I could hit him downfield. He's that big. He doesn't have a lot of run after catchability. Jimmy was really good doing that. Mm-hmm. Short yardage, red zone. When I look at it, the Saints, the Cowboys, New England, how they use their tight ends is positioning downfield, move the chains. And Drew Brees has said this over and over in many interviews about, I think the key in the NFL is to keep your defense on the field.
No doubt. Keep them
out there. Yep. Wear them down. And so a guy like Fleener keeps that defense on the field. He moves the chains. And in the red zone, man, I don't know how many 6-foot defensive backs they have, much less a guy who can match up against Fleener, who's 6'6.5".
And that's what they were missing a little bit last year. As far as the other two guys in free agency, tell us what Craig Robertson and Stupor, kind of the opposite of what Fairley is. These are solid citizen guys. Man of the year for the Browns was Robertson just a couple years ago. Both good guys, not only locker room, special teams, et cetera. What do they bring?
I think that's the big point. Special teams, and also it brings you some veteran depth at the linebacking position. They got whittled down by injuries last year, and so both guys have played both inside and out. They can play on special teams.
We can see Robinson likes to dance,
listen,
too.
Man, I saw him at North Texas. I know what type of player he is. He's a cut up in the locker room, but he is a guy.
You can tell by these pictures, every one of them.
But he is a guy that gives you everything he has out on the field. And the fact that he has played both middle and Sam and even a little weak.
Nice.
He brings you that versatility. Right. Same thing with Stuper.
Right. All right, now we get to have some fun. Let's talk some draft, because I know you have your report coming out. We're going to get to that in a second, how you can get one of those. But the Saints are at number 12. This is a nice spot. Obviously, they picked a spot later last year. But right now, for it seems for what they need, there's a lot of guys out there that are pass rushers or maybe interior linemen. We know that they need some push. They also need guys that can get to the quarterback. I'm going to throw some names at you. And I want some opinions.
Okay.
There's a guy that we saw, obviously, in the postseason a lot, Shaq Lawson. He was terrorizing quarterbacks. You see him right there. But remember in the ACC championship game, he was all over Marquise Williams. And then, obviously, in the semifinal game.
And he was hurt in the national championship game.
He was hurt. And there he is against Baker Mayfield. Oklahoma's offense couldn't do anything against him in that Clemson defense. Talk about him and the possibilities.
One-year wonder. He's been a one-year starter on Clemson's team, but he's a really good athlete, long arm, super quick off the line of scrimmage, gives you some pass rush skills that's not on this football team today. Now, he's got a shoulder injury or shoulder issue that everybody's taking a long look at, but he's a top-half guy in the first round.
Is he? All right, there's another guy that he actually played against that got the better of them in the championship game. That's A'shaun Robinson. Listen, this guy looks like a man. Every picture I see, I said, this guy's at least 35 years old. He's been there before. What does he bring in case the Saints try to go for him?
He's a big man in the middle, the stuff to run. And he's not a great pass rusher. But what he does is he pushes the center of that offensive line right back into the lap of the quarterback. For four straight years, I picked Alabama to beat LSU. This year, I was dumb. I picked LSU. I thought maybe this was their shot.
Next year's the year.
Yeah, right. Well, you can make that pick. It won't be me. But one of those things is I saw him forklift Ethan Posick, who I think is the second best player on LSU's team.
Wow.
Other than Fournette.
Right.
Right back into the lap of Brandon Harris.
All game long.
I was like, this is it. This ain't happening.
This is not
now,
happening.
Again, he's not going to give you that great pass rush, but I go back to last year. Had this team had its kind of wish list, they would have picked Danny Shelton, who's a big run stuffer,
yep.
University of Washington, right. Who went one pick ahead to Cleveland. That's a guy you can kind of look at similar. It's A'shaun Robinson in the middle.
Well, there's another guy you like, and tell us who you think they might take out of Louisville.
Sheldon Rankins, who's a guy who's played across the board. He's played some defensive end, some defensive tackle, a good pass rusher from the middle. He's not the biggest guy in the world as far as when you compare him to a guy like A'shaun Robinson. But he's a good run stuffer, terrific as a pass rusher, very versatile, and he lit it up at the Senior Bowl. But he played well all season long at Louisville.
There he is.
Not a team that you think of from a defensive standpoint, but over the last 2 years, Louisville has put 15 defensive players in the NFL.
Wow.
So
impressive.
Whoever's their recruiting coordinator, he's doing his job.
All right. Maybe some lesser known prospects for some of the fans out there, unless you follow Senior Bowl and stuff like that. A guy that's been through the ringer considering where he was at Ohio State. Then he went to Eastern Kentucky. And then he just blew up the Senior Bowl. You saw it firsthand. Yeah. Noah Spence. Tell me about him. And could he be a guy that Sean Payton takes a chance on?
I doubt it. Sean has never taken a guy with issues with those early picks. When you look at Noah Spence, he was a guy that came in and was a dominant player at Ohio State. He was one of the most highly recruited football players in the country as a prep star. But, man, he's had a ton of issues off the field. But he's probably the best natural pass rusher in this draft class. Somebody's going to take him with a first-round pick. But I'd be willing to bet it won't be the Saints. Now, he's put together now. Man, he
– look at him.
Athletically, man, he is put together. But, again, you take this shot with him is – this. He wasn't picked up for smoking marijuana. He had much deeper issues.
Ecstasy. He liked to have a little fun.
My thing about it is when Urban Meyer kicks you off the Ohio State team, it's not for a one-time offense.
Yeah. If Urban's doing it, you know you've earned it.
You have earned that kickoff.
All right, I forgot. I jumped the gun because we showed a shot of one of the top cornerbacks in the country. He might not be the top. You know, Jalen Ramsey's out there, Vernon Hargraves, but a guy that might be available named Mackenzie Alexander.
Yeah, I like him
nephew.
A lot.
Look at
you know, he's the most fundamentally sound cornerback in his draft class. Now, he's not the biggest and certainly not the fastest. He has not given up a touchdown pass in his college career. I mean, you think about that.
That's incredible.
He's played against some pretty good guys out there.
He plays Florida State every year,
yeah,
right? Jameis Winston.
And so Notre Dame, they've went up against. So when you look at his level of competition and he hasn't given up a touchdown pass, that's impressive. But, again, you put him on the track and he's not going to run the fastest 40. He's not going to have the highest vertical. All I know is, and I learned this long ago, I want a football player. I'm not worried about a guy that can be the lead guy for my 4x400-meter relay team.
Right.
I want a guy that can play football. But some teams fall in love, and some coaches who have immense power fall in love with the athlete. They forget the one big question. Can he play?
Can he play? That's the bottom line. I mean, everybody's like, Laurinaitis, he finished second to last on Pro Football Focus. He's a football player. I need football players and leaders. Real quick, two sleepers, possibilities. One's right here in Louisiana, Vernon Butler. But another Clemson guy, Kevin Dodd. Can you just gloss over those guys real quick?
Kevin Dodd, one-year wonder again at Clemson. He's a guy that if you watch the national championship game, he was in the backfield, man, more than any than Derrick Henry was, to be honest. He was a force air. Lawson got all the link and all the stuff about him. But Kevin Dodd's a guy that I think is a really, really good football player. Vernon Butler, I've seen him for 4 years at Louisiana Tech. His dad was a former basketball player at UL Monroe.
He's a big guy.
He's a big dude in the middle. Now, he doesn't have great pass rush skills, but he's athletic, can stop the run, and he has flashed it as a pass rusher.
Mike, we know the Saints have to hit a home run, not just in the first round, throughout this entire draft. So second round is just as important. A couple guys that you like. I mean, I'm going to start with a guy. We already mentioned cornerback Alexander, but LSU's got one that can play safety and corner.
Yeah, I really like Jalen Mills a lot. Again, he has played free safety, cornerback, in the nickel. Has started every game that he's been healthy at LSU. And
He was on pace for a record until he got hurt this year because he started when Honey Badger went down, remember, as a true freshman. So he was going to have the most starts in LSU history for a bit there.
He's a guy that's just instinctive. He knows how to play this game real well. And I think the name of the game is matchups on third down. As a cornerback, even if he doesn't start for me, I don't take him off the field. And if I've used him as a nickel player, he's playing 70% of my time. So I would love to have Jalen Mills there in the second round. Not only can he play corner, but eventually when you're going to get weary of Jairus Byrd's contract, I can move him to free safety.
Nice. Shalik Calhoun, another pass rushing guy, defensive end. Michigan State had a powerful defense. I'm going to give you two more possibilities in the second round. Tell me what you think about him. Braxton Miller's another one, former quarterback. Obviously, we know what happened there with their situation with Cordell Jones and Barrett. And then he ended up being a wide receiver. So kind of tell me about these two prospects and the second-round possibilities.
Braxton's a guy just learning the wide receiver position, but he can catch the ball and he can flat-out fly. And as a quarterback, you know what to do with the ball in your hands. You make people miss. And he can help you in the return game immediately. Shalik Calhoun is an interesting player. He's a tall drink of water that can get up the field, rush the quarterback. Again, he's not great against the run. But you know what? At this stage, I need a pass rusher, and I think he can help me immediately in that category.
There is not a player I could have brought up that this guy doesn't know everything about. So here's your chance. You have the great draft book coming out. It's going to be out next week. Here's your opportunity to get it. So it's called the M&D Draft Report. We got a graphic here to tell you how to get it through the website and the phone number, but tell people yourself.
They can go on, order it online, saintsreport.com, or they can give us a call at 985-532-6220, and we'll have it out late next week.
Well, what we have out right now is you can get a little gift certificate.
Thank you, brother.
Go
I appreciate
a nice little dinner or lunch over
Thank you. Appreciate
at Legacy Kitchen. And what we do, we got a new tradition. Your cohort, of course, he hogged the top part. You know he does.
He's like John Hancock. He wants to make sure everybody sees that name.
So if you can do a little lighter than Bobby so I can have a little room for some others, anywhere in these two slots, you might get a little right there. But nice to have you, Mike.
Thanks so much. I appreciate it. Thank you, Scott.
Man, it's been a lot of fun.
Sure has. Thank you.
You got to check out You got to check out that draft report. I'm telling you, the first time I saw it, I was blown away. I mean, I was like, man, I didn't know he got that in depth, and it's incredible. Every single player, the needs for every team, it's incredible. And you know what else is incredible? We're going to go into the NCAA tournament deep. Last week, it was just John Brady and I. Well, in a couple segments from now, we're going to have Ed Conroy, the former Tulane head coach. He is in town. But next, we have coming up a special guest. Last week it was Mark Stone for the Mark Stone Band. This week it's Aaron Wilkinson, the lead singer, guitarist, harmonica player from On the Island Swamp Band. Coming up next.
My life. It's full of statistics. Thing is, I could have dropped out of school and become one myself, but I didn't because I had people that believed in me. Here's another statistic. 7,000 students drop out every school day. That's one every 26 seconds. It's time that students know that we believe in them.
Inspire a student and share your message of support at boostup.org.
Of course, it's Derek Freeman in the MFG, and we finally can see Devin Taylor now that my next guest, Aaron Wilkinson, is out of his way. And, of course, Big Game James on the saxophone. Hey, we're going to talk a little NCAA in a second. Next segment, we're going to get into it deep because I have John Brady, who's been my NCAA correspondent for three straight weeks. I'm excited. Had so much fun with him last week. 2 weeks ago, he was with Jordy Collada. And this week, we're joined by Ed Conroy, who was supposed to be with us a couple weeks ago, but he's going to talk tournament, and he played against one of these teams earlier in the year. But right now, we're going to have a little fun because Aaron Wilkinson, he was the lead singer and guitarist, harmonica player, as you see over there with the Honey Island Swamp Band, is joining me right now. And I got to know Aaron about 6-7 months ago. Derek, who I've been friends with for a while, who heads the house band, was like, man, there's a bunch of musicians that listen to your radio show back when I was on ESPN. And Aaron wanted to come join us, and he sat in with us for a whole Friday show we did, one of our live remotes, and then we became friends, and we've been talking sports ever since.
That's right, man. We listen to your show, the band, when we're out on the road. You know, they got all these great
apps
and
things. You really got nothing to do then.
We have some long hours, man. We have some long hours, but.
Well, we had some fun because you and Derek decided, hey, Derek said, let's get a little tournament action going, and I knew you were going to be coming up. So the band and the Redhead Tsunami and Devin didn't participate. John Brady did. I don't have his final numbers, but we'll get those. But early on, I had a nice lead. But you know what? In the first round, that's all you get is 1 point, basically. I know ESPN makes it 10, but it's basically one, and you get two for the second round, and four, and eight, and 16. And we've had different leaders. I mean, Derek actually took over for a while, and you were right there. I think you had the lead briefly.
How the mighty have fallen.
And then all of a sudden, I look. And I'm like, Big Game, and the Redhead Tsunami's been the most consistent. She's been right in the middle the whole time. But then all of a sudden, I see Big Game James, who self-explains that he knows the least about all this. And because Virginia lost to Syracuse, I thought I had this thing done. Well, I didn't get those 8 points. So now Big Game James has the lead. So what do you have to say for yourself?
Well, at least I'm not in last place. I believe Mr. Smoker has that.
He's had a bad run. He's the only guy that didn't have any of the Final Four. Derek, what's up with that now? You were riding Tom Crean all
Michigan
the way to
State. Yeah, Tom Crean I thought was my homie last weekend. I don't know what happened to Tom.
They beat Kentucky for you, though. They did. You were rolling there.
That did happen.
They beat Kentucky.
That was cool. But, yeah, I'm so out. It's not even – yeah, I'm done.
Yeah, you're in fifth. There's well, six if we got Brady, and we'll see. He's on the honor system. We'll catch him up. I just need Oklahoma to win a game. They beat Villanova. I got this. But you know what? If they don't, Kansas, you win, Big James. So we'll get into that later. I got to get in with you because obviously you're with the band. It's festival season. You got a new album coming up. Tell me about what's happening.
We got a new record called Demolition Day. It's out on April 22nd, just in time for Jazz Fest. We'll be at the French Quarter Fest. Maybe have some advanced copies there too. And it's exciting. It's actually a German label. which is kind of a
new thing. That's kind of cool. Yeah, I've been watching the show Vinyl. They have a German label.
They got things in order over there, man.
Well, okay, we have some pictures of your band, and it's funny. Band shots are always interesting because I got you one. Y'all all look so serious right here. No smiles. And I know you as a fun-loving, jovial guy.
Yeah, they wanted us to look tough in that
but
one.
Now you're smiling. You're happy here. We got a few more of
these. That's Mardi Gras. That's different.
Yeah, it looks like you guys have some fun when you're doing this.
We do. That's what it's all about, man. You know, we're having a good time with it and bringing the fun to the people. And, you know, can't take it too seriously. Don't let that first picture fool you.
No, they're not. In fact, they're always fun. Can you tell us when you're going to be at Jazz Fest?
We're going to be there April 29th.
Okay.
So that's the second Friday.
It's a Friday, okay. Mm-hmm. Friday afternoon?
That's right.
All right, that's actually one of the good days. That's when it doesn't get too madhouse during the weekend.
That's right.
As far as festival season, like you said, you're going to be French Quarter Fest. You're going to be rolling around?
That's right. French Quarter Fest, Jazz Fest. You know, it's that time of year here. And then we'll be out on the road taking it all over the country, man.
There you are. There you go. That's outside at a festival, obviously. I see a tent in the background.
Yeah. It's the best time of year.
I got to ask you because you love sports, and you didn't just, as a fan. I mean, you obviously, that's how we became friends. And
that's right.
As a musician, you know as much or more than anybody. You and Derek together know your sports. But you also played, and you're put together well.
Thank you.
Played fullback on a team with a future, now a Hall of Famer. He was a future Hall of Famer at the time. Derek Brooks. I mean, not many people can say they played football with a Hall of Famer. Obviously, Super Bowl winner, Florida State, and then he obviously went on to the Tampa Bay Bucks. Talk about that.
It was cool, man. You know, he was always special. You knew when you were playing with him that he was a different class of athlete. It was apparent.
Right.
And when you had to hit him almost every day in practice like I did, I think I told you our coach believed in full contact, full time. It was a different era then, and, he learned me a few lessons, so it was.
You play fullback, and he's at linebacker, and it's funny because I remember interviewing Bobby Bowden back in the late 90s, and he was saying that he was the first guy that kind of, he recruited him when he was a safety, probably when he was a junior.
That's right.
And then he wanted him as a linebacker because, that became a trend, getting guys like Jermaine Kearse, who was a safety, then a linebacker, then a defensive end. Well, you played against him at both eras. I mean, did you knew this guy was going to be special? I mean, that he was going to be that good?
I mean, you felt like the sky was the limit, but then I think he exceeded even what you thought was possible. And it's, when you're playing with somebody who's clearly the best player on the field, it's sort of like you don't have anybody to compare him to, like,
exactly.
How good is this guy,
exactly,
really,
right.
But then, I'll just say that I don't think anybody was surprised to see him go on and become Super Bowl champion, Hall of Famer. I mean, it was clear he had that in him.
Well, he ended up being the best player on Florida State's team, who they were dominant, top five every year he was there. And then he and Warren Sapp just dominated. Their offenses were just kind of nondescript. But, man, those defenses, they got a Super Bowl. Obviously, John Gruden had come over. He was their head coach with Tampa Bay. And who would have thought that of all the teams in the division, Tampa Bay would have been the first to get the Super Bowl. But the Saints were the second. And I know you're a big Saints fan. Here's our tradition. You got a little gift certificate.
Thank you so much.
To go eat over there at the restaurant. And I'm going to get the rest of the band gift certificates. I got one. We're working on that. And I promise you guys, we're going to get you going. But here, there's a little tradition to sign the ball. I appreciate you. That's Aaron Wilkinson. Check him out. Like I said, Jazz Fest, Friday afternoon, second weekend. Obviously, French Quarter Fest. Look him up. Honey Island Swamp Band, one of the best in town. And that's not just me saying it. That's pretty much every mountain say. So, hey, we're coming back, and I cannot wait for this segment. We have two coaches. Ed Conroy is going to join me along with John Brady, former LSU coach. LSU Tulane going at it next right here on Primetime Sports.
The mark of Legacy Kitchen is simple. We offer numerous dishes like chicken enchilada soup, prime filet and loaded baked potato, baby back ribs, and so much more. At Legacy Kitchen, we serve American fare, crafted cocktails, and we offer a great selection of wines by the glass. Metairie at Vets and Martin Berman, and in the Warehouse District at Chapatoulas and Girard.
North Shore Basketball Training Center is located at 70239 Highway 59 in Abita Springs. Here we offer developmental programs for all ages, focusing on structure, hard work, putting forth great effort, and teamwork.
North Shore Basketball Training Center also offers year-round basketball teams, leagues, camps, speed and agility conditioning, and other programs to help enrich our students. North Shore Basketball Training Center, 985-373-7367 or NorthShoreSportsPlex.com.
Welcome back. That is Derek Freeman in the MFG. And special guest who you just saw right here on the interview stage was Aaron Wilkinson with Honey Island Swamp Band. I cannot wait for this next segment. Mike Detillier was fantastic. Love football, but I love basketball most. And here it is. This is the NCAA tournament. And I've got two guys that both coached in the NCAA this year. One was supposed to be here a few weeks ago, and you had a tragedy, so you couldn't come. And of course, Ed Conroy, the former coach of Tulane Green Wave, former Arkansas State, LSU, Samford head coach. John Brady, who's been my NCAA correspondent. First of all, John, I got to thank you, man. This is 3 weeks in a row.
It's been fun.
We talked about it about a month and a half ago, and it has come to fruition.
I'm going to have withdrawals next week. Won't know what to do.
We'll bring you on. Hey, before the draft, you know some of these players. We'll get you on before then for sure. All right, Ed, we missed you a couple weeks ago. I know your cousin, your first cousin, which people, if you might be surprised to know, the novelist, which I know in school you probably had to read a few of the books, at least one or two of them. Pat Conroy passed away, and you took care of business back home. So talk about that and your relationship.
Well, Pat and I were very close. His dad was the oldest of nine. My dad was the youngest of that nine from the south side of Chicago. But his dad, in the mid-70s, right when The Great Santini was written, and that movie came out, Pat's dad was retiring from the Marine Corps, so he actually moved in and lived every summer up at our house. At that time, we were living in Davenport, Iowa, and he'd be there pretty much May, June, July, right on through the summer. So he became our favorite uncle. And then, of course, I went to the Citadel, so I kind of spent – that's where his family was. So a lot of time around Pat down there in South Carolina, we became very close.
I know the feeling because I'm the youngest of my – and my parents were the youngest of their family, so I've got – cousins at least 20 years older, so I know exactly what you're talking about. Hey, speaking of Citadel, I have to bring this up because Pat wrote a book called Lords of Discipline, and for those of you who don't know, it was made into a great movie. Mark Breland, the Olympic boxer, played it. But it's about, you know, what goes on at the Citadel. And it's like if you've had anything to do with a cadet school or a school that military style, well, it's not easy. Now, that was 20 years before you. He kind of spilled the beans on what's going on. I have to ask you, did you have it tough, or did playing basketball at the Citadel help you in the mid-80s?
Playing basketball or any sport at a military school doesn't help you that freshman year. You still have to go through it. And really, at that time, when I was being recruited, the movie had just come out. So Conroy was kind of a four-letter word at that time at the Citadel. And
that's my point.
No question.
So you had to have taken some heat.
Took quite a bit. It didn't take him long to figure out you know, that we were related. And Pat actually was banned from campus, you know, at that time.
Yeah, I know.
You know, the one thing he said, people asked him, you know, about, they heard that, you know, I was going to the Citadel, and did he have any thoughts on that? He said, well, it just shows you how low the Citadel has, how they've lowered their standards because now they've recruited a basketball player that obviously can't read because I wrote a 500-page book.
Right. All right, speaking of his books, I'm going to put you on the spot. What are some of your favorites?
Well, you know, I always like The Great Santini, and it probably goes to...
I mean, you read them all in Cliff Notes, though, right?
No, I live part of them, his first couple, the Water is Wide and The Great Santini, I think those were maybe because they were his first ones that I really liked those. And then I was so close with his dad,
the
Great Santini, so... I felt like I was always reciting lines at the movie just to kind of jab at him a little bit and things like that. So those have always been my favorites.
Well, I put the graphic up when he passed away, and I did this because in honor of him, I mean, you were going to be on that particular show. And I didn't look this up. These are the first six that came to mind. I don't know if I can even name more than this, but, you know, these are pretty well-known books. I mean, come on, Prince of Tides was a huge movie. Obviously, My Losing Season was great. That was the one. About the hoops, right? And then
absolutely.
And obviously Lords of Discipline, Great Santini with Robert Duvall in that one. So the man is a great writer. And obviously the family, y'all are all very close.
We are. And they had a great send-off for him in South Carolina. It was tough, but you know, great send-off for him. And he followed our season very closely. And then he told me one of the last things he had done, he had seen us play.
you know, in the days leading up to it. So it was neat.
Speaking of great send-offs, and John, I promise you I'm going to get you in. But speaking of, you had to come back and coach in the American Athletic Conference tournament. And for the first time, Tulane won two games in that tournament against a team they hadn't beaten 10 tries since 2007. UCF was the first one. And then you come back, Houston, who was trying to get in the tournament. I mean, they had a whale of a season. Yeah, but they really needed to get a victory, and then they probably would have been in. So talk about that, and then I have to bring this up because we all know that there were the rumors circulating and the leak and all this that you were going to be let go. So kind of bring us through what that was like for those few days.
Emotional week, but, you know, to say the least. But you fly back in town, and, you know, our guys, we knew early on in the season, we had such a young team. And we knew after a few losses early in the year, one of them being Carolina, that our chances to be in that large team, you know, were slim and none. We had to point toward March, point toward winning that tournament. And that was really the focus of all of our practices and trying to just, you know, keep improving. And so to come back, you know, after the, you know, going down to South Carolina to be with my family, our guys are a special group. And then they were there for me. And then to see how they came together during that tournament. And finally, I thought we started to really play. You know, up to our capabilities. But again, we were so young, I thought we would continue to improve throughout the year, and they certainly showed that.
Were you surprised at the choice of Mike Dunleavy? And I'm going to ask you, can you give him any advice? Because this guy's never coached college. The facilities aren't like they are at some of the other schools he's competing against, so he's never really recruited. You got a little smirk in your face. What's some advice you'd give him?
Well, you know, I don't think I need to give Coach Dunleavy, you know, any advice. But
17-year coach in the NBA, yeah, though, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And, right. You know, Tulane's a great place, and you know, it's. I think there's a wonderful group of young men that are there. That I think there's a core and a foundation that he can really build off of and grow with. That was our vision. I think he'll do just fine because Tulane's, you know, like I said, a great place. And New Orleans, you know, I've fallen in love with this city, me and my family, and it's a tremendous place to be.
And if you leave, you're going to miss it. And I'm sure you got a lot of coaching in you, so unfortunately you probably will be gone, but we'll miss you for sure. Now we get to talk NCAA tournament. Now we're going to have some fun.
Let me say something here about this. That's a great – see, I think a lot of people sometimes don't understand there's a different part of what a coach goes through as opposed to just coaching his team and you win or lose the game and – that's as deep as it goes. But, you know, to hear you talk about that and the family and the involvement with players and things that happen to a coach, the administration leaks something out while you're coaching a game or however that came down, you know, it's something that people don't understand what you went through and the way you handled that and what he said about it really speaks highly of you and your character by going through something that's difficult because I've been there with you, brother. And I wish y'all the best.
It's a true fraternity. You guys know.
As Coach John Lucas called me the next morning, he said, welcome to coaching. You're officially a member. I know you've been coaching 25 years, but you're officially in
that's
now.
Right.
And, you know, one of the things about our team that was really neat, and I'll never forget the post-game celebration in that locker room against Houston because it did mean so much to them.
And
they knew what a week was. But then we got back to the hotel. And I wanted to do a little bit of recovery because I knew we had a quick turnaround now in the semis against Memphis. And so the guys are up there, and they're just going to stand in the pool. And, you know, just kind of one of the things we do with the trainers, have them do to kind of get their legs back a little bit. And I walked up to the check on them. The next thing I know, Dylan Oskakowski and those guys are throwing me in the pool.
Nice.
And it was one of the, you know, it's one of those things as a coach
you'll never forget.
Yeah,
you'll never forget. And what John was alluding to was how classy, and I always say if you use the word classy, you ain't classy. But how class act that Ed Conroy did handling the interview after when all the leak came out, and then after the game they won against Houston, it was dynamic. Like I said, if I was his agent, I would have been like, two thumbs up. Let's talk tournament now. I got to get into it because, I mean, these things kind of fly by before you know it and the show's over. So, first of all, the one thing I feel good about so far is that Oklahoma, I think a lot of us had Oklahoma in the Final Four other than Derek, but most of us did. But the fact is that I have him to win it all. Buddy Hield has been riding high. This guy has been unbelievable, but can they get it done? I'm going to start with you, John, first, and then we're going to show you some stats by Buddy Hield. Regular season, they were phenomenal. And then you see what he's done in the postseason. It's out of this world. It's really been crazy. But talk about Buddy and this team, because it's not just Buddy. They've got a bunch of other players.
Well, you picked him as College Player of the Year, and I think he's proven that. I don't think there's any question about that. I think for Villanova to have an opportunity to beat this team is I think they need to take him out. I don't think you can let him score his and then maybe shut the other guys down. I think they're too talented. I think the core of their team is doing something as we kind of tried to do against J.J. Redick and Duke. You know, is take him out, Don't let him score. Make him struggle and make something else happen with that team.
But look at these numbers. I mean, he already averaged 25. For the college game, that's outrageous. 29.5 in the tournament. Look at the field goal percentage this guy. This guy didn't shoot anything but 35-footers, right?
The three-point field goal stat's incredible.
But he doesn't even shoot many layups anyway, so he's 57% from the field, 48% from three. Great numbers.
Oh, tremendous numbers, and it's going to be, I agree with Coach, you got to find a way to try to make it tough. And Villanova's got the numbers of guys that defend at a high level that they can maybe rotate some guys on them and make it tough, but I don't know if you can really stop Buddy Hield.
But here's the other thing. It's not just Hield. This is why I picked him. Hield's the one thing, but they're senior-laden. And you guys know as coaches, when you get seniors in your program that's stuck around, Cousins, Woodard, Spangler, the entire starting lineup is made of seniors. I think that goes a long way, Coach.
Oh, well, he's a classic example of what a four-year player is about in college basketball. You get a guy like him that stays there 4 years, and I think it's great for the game because he is the best player in the country. He is putting up big numbers, and I think that should tell other players they should stay in the college game maybe a year or two.
All right, the band, as well as yourself, as well as the Redhead Tsunami, y'all all picked Kansas and Michigan State in the final. You weren't alone. A lot of the country did, but Kansas got shocked the other day. Look at this dismay right there on the guard's face. He's like, I can't believe this is going on. That's a late shot at the end of the game. Villanova pulls it out. It's not like it's a huge surprise because Villanova's got a really good team. Jay Wright's been in the Final Four, but I think a lot of people are riding on Kansas being the favorite, Coach.
Well, Ed can speak on this. He's up east a little bit, but I've always thought we played Villanova when I was at LSU years back. I think the difference in this year's Villanova's team is they finally have some guys around the basket that can rebound it and defend the post. In the past, I thought they'd get beat deep in NCAA tournament because they weren't very good around the goal. Now they've got a stretch four. Now they've got a guy who can rebound and defend around the basket. And I think that gives them a little more balance now, particularly on the defensive end, because they've always been guard-oriented.
I agree with you. And I think when I think of this, the Villanova team, I think balance. I think both ends of the floor. And I think that's what's going to propel them into the championship
game. No, you like
game.
Nova, okay.
They
are good, man.
Yeah,
they really are good.
I think Villanova, just with their numbers and of guys with the toughness they bring.
And they're a team. They're a true team, as you see. I mean, they're celebrating right here. Don't you think that they kind of personify a team?
No question. I think they just find a way to make winning plays, which in the past coaches alluded to, they were so guard-oriented. They relied on, that perimeter play so much. Now I think they have a variety of ways that they can beat you, and they just play the right way. They make the winning plays when they need to.
I'm going to go with Coach Conroy. We're going to gang up on you.
No, I'm going to Oklahoma.
I'm Villanova,
man. I might have to bring you in next week when we win the title. All right, I'll bring you in. I'll bring you both back. Hey, by the way, the team that kind of let me down because I thought I might have a chance at the final together, and I had Virginia going against Oklahoma. Virginia had a 15-point lead, went to eat some Easter dinner, got back, and they were down four. And I'm like, what happened here? And then they got down six, and then they kind of got it closer. But the shocker of the day, Syracuse, first of all, averages like 50 points a game. They got 47 points in the second half alone after trailing by 15 at the half, down 16 at one point in the second half, and they come back, make the run, put the press on. Great coaching by Jim Boeheim. Talk about this victory because they're going to the Final Four for the fifth time in Boeheim's career.
Well, both coaches are outstanding. And I think in college basketball today with a 30-second shot clock, 15 and 16-point leads aren't what they used to be. I think Boeheim put the press on at the right time, and it's amazing how they control, Virginia controlled the game the whole way until the press hit them. They lost their composure. They had some turnovers, and with that short stretch, it changed the game and allowed Syracuse to have a chance to win it.
I'm going to say this, Coach, because in the beginning, people forget this, that Syracuse got out to an 8-2 lead, so the matchup zone was driving Virginia nuts, and that was like 6 minutes in. And it was all planned towards Syracuse, and all of a sudden, London Perantes got hot, and he hit five threes, and all of a sudden, that's when they went up big. But when it was kind of staying the same the entire second half is when they put the press on. So they have two aces in Jim Boeheim's little, his little toolkit, that press and obviously the matchup zone. So he used them both effectively.
Basketball is a game of rhythm and runs, and a lot of people forget about what you just mentioned as far as that beginning of the game where Virginia couldn't score.
Right.
But then they did find their rhythm, and they controlled it, as Coach said, for a long period of time. But I think it was really interesting in this tournament when you look at Virginia, Wisconsin, Northern Iowa, three of the most well-coached teams in the country.
Great.
And they all had collapses. and you know, against the pressure when there was a change in the pressure and the rhythm of the game changed and kids turned it over. And then just every program that's this far in the tournament, they have a winning culture.
Right.
And those kids believe in it. And there's so many seniors in this year's tournament and things like that, that just the end of game pressure changed a lot of things. And that was fun to watch.
All right. Boeheim has been literally at Syracuse since Kennedy turned it over, obviously, when he passed away, and Lyndon Johnson. He played from 63 to 66, was a coach, assistant coach for several years, and I think people would be surprised. He took over in 1976, and get this, Syracuse, when he was an assistant, had a head coach named Roy Danforth, who took them to the Final Four in 75, right? That's the last year UCLA won. Remember, they had that break when NC State got that in 74, but they had won all the ones before. They got that one, Wooden's last year, but Syracuse got there. A year later, he comes down to Tulane on his own. And Jim Boeheim, and you have a story behind it. Jim Boeheim, we're going to show some numbers. He's been there 40 years, and every year he's been able to go to the tournament because they had 2 years they went ineligible, including last year in the early 90s. He's gone to the postseason every year, 38 out of 38. Six of them were in the NIT, 32 in the NCAAs, 18 Sweet 16s, seven Elite Eights, and this will be his fifth Final Four. Talk about when you played Syracuse recently, what he told you.
We're playing Syracuse a couple years ago, and you know, coaches have their pregame handshake, and I look down, and Coach Boeheim's walking toward me, and he's got that smirk on his face. I'm thinking, you know, what has happened? What is he about to tell me? And he stuck his hand out to shake my hand, and he said, Tulane, my second favorite school. And,
because he got the chance.
And he looked at me to see if I'd have a reaction, and I looked right back at him. I said, Roy Danforth. He said, absolutely. I'm glad you know your history.
and Roy Danforth, and people that from New Orleans know the May 3rd flood in the late 70s, his car was literally up to the windows right in front of my house, so I helped push him out. So that's a little backstory to you. Hey, real quick, I got to go get to North Carolina. You played the Tar Heels. They're the team I think most people consider the favorites right now. There's Tulane and, of course, your great senior, Lewis Dabney. But talk about this team going forward, and I want your analysis on it right after that.
Well, I have to be a man of my word, and I told our team in the locker room after that game that this is a team. If they shoot the ball like they did it against us, you're going to see them win the national championship.
Y'all played them tough.
We did play
them tough.
But and I thought we played better than the final score indicated. And the reason I thought that at the time is that was the only game all year Carolina had made 10 threes until they just did it recently in the tournament here, and it was against us that night. And I knew watching that game that Carolina had played well. They had executed well on the offensive end, and if they make the threes like that, they're almost impossible to beat.
Hey, Coach, I want to get you because you were going to the Final Four. You were there 10 years ago, okay? Mm-hmm. You know the four coaches. This is Lon Kruger's second. Obviously, this is Jay Wright's second. He lost to Roy Williams. And Roy Williams himself has been eight times, four with Kansas, four with Carolina. He's won two with Carolina. And then Boeheim has that. I was at the finals in 87. They lost Indiana last second shot. I was in 96 in the Meadowlands. I was there when Kentucky beat him. And then I was here in the Dome when he got his first title. This guy gets there and wins, but you've been there. What are these guys going through right now leading up to Final Four week?
Well, the biggest thing is forget about what happened and start over again. Kind of like the movie 50 First Dates. That has nothing to do with what you're about to go through. And the second thing is the head coach managing the time of the of interviews and people wanting to talk to the coach and the players. And I think the biggest thing is to get the players to focus on what lies ahead, forget what just happened, has nothing to do with the preparation for the next game.
Do you think the experience these guys haven't been there helps them, or is it no big deal?
Oh, I think it helps. Right. I think it helps having gone through that and just knowing, like Coach said, managing, every year is a different, little bit of a different journey, but just managing the time and the hours you have as you get toward that, and really the emotions, and recognizing, having been there, you get a better sense of recognizing within your own guys how the emotions are playing out in them.
25 minutes just flies by. I mean, I wish I could do another half hour with you guys. It's been a treat for me. Coach, I wish you the absolute best. I really do. And
see you
as well. I've got some gift certificates. We're going to go to Legacy Kitchen after. We're going to have a little lunch. You signed this ball. We're going to put you in there. Hey, you know what? You can even go in the Saints corner. I don't care. I love you, Ed. Ed Conroy.
That.
John Brady, I got to thank you for three full weeks of this. This has been great.
Appreciate it.
And I'm happy that you're moving down to New Orleans, and I'm not sure you're going to be completely retired, but
might see you around town sometime.
I have a feeling. I have a feeling. I have a good feeling. Hey, I want to thank everybody. Derek Freeman, the MFG. I can't thank these guys enough. Big game, James, my man right there. He's holding on to that Kansas lead, so if Oklahoma loses, James wins. Hey, Devin Taylor on the tuba, phenomenal back there. Of course, Derek Freeman, our special guest. I love having Aaron Wilkinson. Also want to thank, you know, my guy, Mike Detillier. He was fantastic for these two guys right here. I want to thank everybody for watching the show. I want to thank, man, Will back there. William Hill does an incredible job. Naila and Kenny and all the guys. And thank all the guys that make this possible. But also, you can catch me each and every day. I am on scout.com, saintsinsider.com, pelicanspride.com. I hadn't been that much fun to write about, but I still do it every day, usually two, three stories a day for each of those. Check them out. And you can also catch us on the replay. You know, if you're watching this on Tuesday and you miss half of Mike Detillier, it's going to be Thursday night at 10. If it's already Thursday, we'll catch you next week. Thanks for watching us on Primetime Sports with Scott Alexander. We'll be back.